well, I'm a chicken fried. A cold beer on a Friday night. A pair of jeans that fit just right. And the radio. Whoa, whoa.
Happy July, everybody. Hope you're all doing well. Mr. Moran here. I'm in my backyard in front of my favorite place to be in the summer, and that's my barbecue grill. All right? For those of you who ever had me for class, you know that one of the things I absolutely love to do is the grill. Right? I always tell my students I'm not very good at many things, but I'm definitely good at grilling. And I love doing it. So today I'm gonna teach you a little bit of how to grill my favorite food, and that's spare ribs. Now spare ribs, it really matters what kind of rib you get. You gotta get the baby back, right? You can go with like a St. Louis rib, which tastes good and all that, but the baby back rib is the prime type of rib you want to get if you're gonna be barbecuing. All right, so in order to grill these properly, it's gonna take about 5.5 hours. So I hope you've got nothing else scheduled for today, because in order to get these things going to the perfect temperature and to the perfect fall of the bone tenderness, it's about 5.5 to 6 hours that we're gonna be here together. Don't worry, I'm gonna edit the video down so we can do it all in about 20 minutes, all right? And at the end, we'll have some special guests come around to enjoy the ribs with me on this beautiful July afternoon. So, a few things to get us ready. As you can see over here, I got my stack of ribs. I'll bring the kind of the camera over here so you can see. I got my stack of ribs. They're covered in plastic wrap right now. I seasoned them this morning. What I did to season them, let me put the camera back over here just so you guys can kind of see. Let's see. There we go. What I did to season them was I took a mixture of paprika, chili powder, salt, pepper, brown sugar, and some cumin, and I put it all in a bowl and I mixed it together. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna post the recipe for the rub for the ribs right on the in the group here for you guys as well, so you have everything you need. What you do is you take everything you need, you put it into a nice bowl, you shake it up and you mix it around. In order to prepare the ribs properly, the very important step you have to do is you have to take the membrane off the back of the rib, all right? Because otherwise it holds the meat on the bone and they don't fall off as easily, all right? So I also have a website for a link of how you do that. It's real simple. You take the end of a thermometer, like a meat thermometer, and you just press that along the bone, along the back, and you pop it up. And this thin skin called the membrane will kind of pop up. You take a paper towel and you just rip it right off. You throw that in the garbage, all right? So all my ribs are prepared. I did that earlier today for you, all right? So we can get right into the grill, to the grilling. I got my grill pretty much prepared. What I've been doing is I'm getting the smoke ready. So in order to use the proper smoking technique, you need to take a bucket, fill it with water, and inside the bucket you put wood chips. All right, now what I have is I have a mixture of hickory and a mixture of mesquite wood chips that we're gonna use to smoke with. Now when I open my grill, you can see I've got the smoke kind of coming out through my smoke box over here. I've got this grill spot here on high to get the smoke going. And so now I got some good smoke that I can use. So I'm gonna close that bad boy up so we just smoke, all right? Now, I'm gonna turn this light to low because I don't want it to be a fire. I want it to smoke. And then I'm gonna turn on the other side of the grill as well to a low. We're gonna prepare the grill for what you call indirect heat, slow cooking, all right? And we're gonna use a method that I always refer to as the stack and swap, all right? You see, my grill is not big enough to give me enough grill space for four racks of ribs next to each other, not over any heat, because otherwise they'll cook too fast. So we're gonna do what I call the stack and swap method, all right? It's very simple. All we're gonna do is we're gonna stack the ribs on top of each other in the middle of the grill, all right? So let's go ahead and get that done here this morning for us. All right, let's see, make sure you guys can see, all right? So I got my two tongs, right? All those guys that use like giant spatulas and forks and stuff like that, two tongs, that's all I need. There's really everything you grill, you can use tongs with, right? So we're just gonna take one rack of ribs, right? Nicely seasoned. right, and rubbed with our spicy barbecue rub. Put that right in the middle. And put the second one right on top. Rack number three, also going right on top. And then rack number four is gonna go right on top of that. All right, so let me see kind of what I got going on our setup here. So you see our stack method. Oh, I'm covering the camera with my finger, don't wanna do that. So there's our stack method. You see the smoke coming up. Notice both grill here, bottoms are on low, both on low. We want the grill to be a temperature of about 250 to 300 degrees throughout this whole process, all right? And so from here, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna set a timer for 45 minutes, all right? 45 minutes, I'm gonna leave the grill shut. I'll monitor the temperature so that it gets about 250, but never higher than 300, all right? And I'll come back in 45 minutes and we'll rotate the stack of the ribs, right? So the top one's gonna go to the bottom, right? And then the bottom one's gonna go to the second will go to the third will go to the top, right? We're gonna do that for every 45 minutes for 6 hours, all right? This way we get it all done properly, all right? So I'll be back, right? You guys take a little break. That's the nice thing about the ribs that, you know, it's easy to do. It takes a lot of time, but you can kind of do whatever you want now for the next couple minutes, all right? So I'll be back in 45 minutes, or as far as this video is concerned, about a couple seconds. There he is, 45 minutes. What have you been doing? All right, well, it hasn't been 45 minutes for you. It's time to rotate the ribs. So here we go. Let me set the iPad up. Make sure you guys can see. All right.
And if you're by yourself, no worries.
Here we
go. Just follow after me. Yeah. Gonna do the two-step, then cowboy boogie. Grab a sweetheart and spin out with him. Do the hold down and get into it. Take it to the left now and dip with it. Gonna throw down, take a sip with it. Now lean back, put your hips in it. Let's have some fun. To the left, to the left now. To the right, to the right.
45 minutes, this is what we're doing. Go ahead, guys.
Put it on your side.
That's it. Let's go. Time to swim.
Do the slip and slide.
There he is. He gets it. Johnny doesn't like
it. My favorite part of this time to shine. Gonna do the two-step, then cowboy boogie. Grab a sweetheart and spin out with him. Do the hold down and get into it. Take it to the left now and dip with it. Don't throw down. Take a sip with it. And lean back with your hips.
Fourth time rotating. Change because I mowed the lawn.
Slide to the left, slide to the right. Now cool down, have a good time. Slide to the left, slide to the right. Do the butterfly, have a good time. Round.
I'm gonna show you guys something. So you can see which one hasn't been on top of it. You guys see that? You see the middle? The middle hasn't been on top. You can see it hasn't had the caramelization that the ones on the sides have. So this is our last time here rotating. After this rotating, we're gonna start softening them up as we rotate. So, all right, here we go. Alright everybody, so when you got a lot of 45 minute increments here during the rib making, I get a chance to do a little Bible reflection. So I was kind of thinking about what to talk about during this time period, because I wanted it to be something that, I don't know, it was important. And so I kept coming up with the same idea. When I went for a run the other day, that song by Thomas Rhett, 16. You guys ever hear that song? I'm sure you have. A lot of people love Thomas Rhett. He's definitely, he's really growing on me. I really enjoy him. But the whole song to me is intriguing, right? Because it's always pointing towards the future, right? When he's 15, he wants to be 16 so that he can drive his truck around town. When he's 17, he wants to be 18 so he can go out with his friends. When he's 18, or when he's 20, he wants to be 21 so he can go out. All right, and then when he's 25, he gets to that point where he feels as though, like, he made it. Now he's looking back at the time, right? And part of what I really thought was interesting about the song, right, is just kind of this tendency from ourselves as human beings to never be complacent with the present, right? To always be looking forward towards the future, right? And when we look forward towards the future, that tends to make some of us anxious, right? I don't know about you guys, but you might not realize this, but I definitely have a lot of anxiety, right, in my life. Not like where I'm like crippling anxiety. I wouldn't say that I'm like depressed or like clinical anxiousness, but I do worry a lot. I have a lot of worries about things. Like somebody sends me an email saying, call me. Immediately I'm like, what's the problem? What's going on, right? Or I'm always looking at like what could go wrong, and it's not always a good thing, right? It's not always a good thing, right? You know, I always, I don't know, anxiety, it can kind of like freeze you up. And so what I thought we would do is we should take a look at the Gospels and kind of see like what does Jesus have to say about being anxious, right? About the present and about the future. All right, so I got a gospel passage here. This is from Matthew chapter 6. I'm going to read it to you guys. Jesus says, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor about your body, what you shall put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit to his lifespan? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O men of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be yours as well. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Let the day's own trouble be sufficient for the day. You know, I absolutely love that passage, right, for me, because it kind of just reminds myself, right, that I need to step back and stop worrying about and being in charge of my own life. That I need to make sure that I am relying on God for more of the things that I do. So I'll tell you a little story. I mean, I have lots of stories of how God has really just led me through my life. And if you guys want some time, just let me know and we'll sit down in my office and have some gummy bears and we can talk about it. But that's a story for another day. But last week, the drain in my kitchen broke, right? So we had our kitchen redone about 2 or 3 years ago, and all of a sudden there's water leaking out underneath my sink into my kitchen floor. So I open up underneath the sink and look for a leak in the pipes, and there's nothing. It's bone dry. I'm like, where is this water coming through from? So I go into the basement in the crawl space. Sure enough, right under the kitchen sink, there is water just coming into my basement. I'm like, oh, geez, the insulation is all moldy and black. It's nasty. And I'm like, where is the water coming from? Turns out that the pipe that was behind my kitchen cabinets, that's in the wall that goes into the basement, that's what's leaking, right? So, of course, my anxious mind, I'm like, oh, my goodness, how are they going to get this out, right? I start freaking out. I call my buddy who has fixed done plumbing work in his own house, and he's telling me, like, oh, dude, they're going to have to cut a giant hole in the back of your kitchen cabinet. They're going to have to pull this thing out, right? They're going to have to do all this work. He's like, this is not going to be a cheap ordeal, you know, like $2,000 job minimum. And I was like freaking out. I was, you know, just so nervous, so worried. And so the next day I call a plumber that my brother had used, and he comes in and he's like, oh, don't worry, this is an easy fix. We'll just repipe it. We'll drill a hole straight through the bottom of the cabinet, run a new hole, take the old pipe out of the wall and cap what we couldn't get to. No problem, $300. It's like, all right. You know, my anxious level is down a little bit, but still, like, $300 is a lot of money to come up with out of nowhere. So this summer, I've been doing a little bit of work in the mornings when I can, chopping firewood. And that morning, right, the day that the plumber was coming, they're not paying me a ton of money to do this, but I went on tips on some of the deliveries, and I got enough tips to cover almost all of the cost of the plumber. And I hadn't gotten really any tips all summer. And just this one day, all of a sudden, here come the tips, come flowing in. And it's just moments like that in my life that I'm reminded of this passage, right? When God says to me, do not be anxious. Don't you know that I love you? Don't you know that I will take care of everything that you have going on? All right, and there is so much to be anxious about right now in the world. Is school going to open up again in the fall? Am I going to get sick? Is somebody I love going to get sick? All right, mom and dad, are they going to lose their job because of everything that's going on? Or are they going to have the food that I need at the grocery store? I mean, the list could go on of what to be anxious about. And here it is, folks. It's clear as day, right? The birds of the air, they neither reap nor sow or gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Right? I see the birds constantly around my yard. They're working hard, right, building their nests, and they're gathering. But they're happy. They're provided for. And if God loves them, He loves us just so much more. And so I think that's kind of my message here, right? Because with ribs, there's a lot of waiting. There's a lot of looking to the future. There's a lot of wanting to get to the end of the six-hour process of making these ribs so that you can just destroy them and we can say, what shall we eat? Right? But it's important to live in the present moment. Don't always look to the future and be anxious about the future. Enjoy life in the present. All right, enjoy life in the present. Enjoy the relationships that you have, right? Enjoy the time with your family. And ultimately, above all, love God, right? And notice what he says in here, right? What's the only thing that we should do? Verse 33, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. If we seek to do the will of God, everything else will fall into place. All right, guys. So, according to the gospel here, what shall we eat? We eat ribs. Here we go. Coming up. All right, folks, here we go. Number five. Here's the important time now. Now we got to start putting the barbecue sauce on the ribs. All right, so we still got our smoke going, as you can see. The stack is coming along nicely. So what we're going to do now is we're going to start to put our homemade barbecue sauce on the ribs. Now the homemade sauce is a mixture of a lot of brown sugar, some apple juice, some bourbon, right? So some ketchup, some liquid smoke, some hot sauce, and some salt and some pepper, all good things. I'll put the recipe for you guys in the chat as well, so you guys can make the sauce with your parents. Make sure your parents do it with you, because you guys shouldn't be accessing bottles of bourbon. Don't worry, all the alcohol is cooked off, though, when you boil it and mix it together. All right, so once again, right, we're gonna take our top two, because they're gonna go.
You better not have said hot sauce, Daddy.
All right, for the sides, add switching. So my kids, during the 45 minutes, they filled up these, you know, sanitation gloves, and they've been sitting them in the sun, so they're nice and hot. All right, so now we got them here. All right, I got my homemade barbecue sauce here. Let's see if I can. All right, so I realized I hit the off button when I was doing the barbecue sauce. So let me show you. All right, here's what the barbecue sauce looks like, my little concoction, right? So all you're gonna do is you're gonna take it and lather it on top. On all the sides. They say the grass is always green. Alright, let me give you guys a close up now. So you can see I gotta move my log that I'm using to hold on. Alright, you see that? Looking good. Looking good. Alright, so far it's been on there. Right, I put them on at 12. It's 3 o'clock now, so about halfway there. All right, halfway, almost there, folks. It's gonna be eating good tonight. Can't wait.
We make the best way.
Here's Brother Vito.
Hi guys.
Joining us for the ribs. So, hold on, he doesn't know what to do yet. He just got here. We gotta tell him. We gotta do the stack and swap, right?
Oh, there goes the baby.
Uh-oh, Emma's gonna play with the iPad.
Baby?
sauce them up. Just painting it on in case you can't see, I'll bring you over. I don't know what my daughter did. She was doing
it. She just played with it. That's fine.
That was the
just
iPad.
The top one or all of them?
Oh, you do the sides of the other ones.
Oh, cool.
Let it all run down.
Got it on my shirt, but that's the point.
That's it. That's why we can't have nice things. It's a Suffolk living right here.
Type of valve poverty. Can somebody buy me a shirt?
All right. That looks good.
And shoes. I just got on my shoes.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. All right, folks. See you again in 45 minutes. It's the cornerstone that held us all up through the best of times. And made our way when times got tough. So we had this all set up in a little move away. We're gonna finish the ribs here. We've been rotating them. 12 o'clock. Toilet paper, hold that. Make yourself useful.
Never.
Alright. We're gonna do what we call the Texas crunch. Right? We're gonna take the ribs now off the grill. We're gonna wrap them in tin foil. So this way they got tenderized for the last 30 minutes or so. Besides about this, you keep some pipe in the hot. This way when you go to serve it, they're fantastic. You need them better. Better tomorrow than we are today. Alright, put it in the tin foil, and then you dump a little barbecue sauce on top. That adds the moisture. One. We do that four times for each round.
Reminds me of the time I played St. Lawrence and I had to go play. That's fun.
You played St. Lawrence?
Yeah.
Like you were St. Lawrence?
Yeah, like I was on fire. And I told them, turn me over. That's the most passive aggressive way to become a saint.
Turn me over. Love peace. Thank you, Peter. For another 30 minutes or so, and then we'll be ready to eat, and I'll let you see what they look like. Alright, here we go, back in 45. Alright folks, here it is, 6 hours, 6 o'clock, right, let's about time to see what it is. So, I don't know if you can see here, this is my operation in my kitchen, I got all the ribs packed up here, right, I got the rest of my dinner, right, we've got a nice salad. All right, we got a nice cucumber salad over here. It's probably my ultimate favorite thing. I got a girl wearing a Mets cap. That's Elizabeth. I got John shooting Nerf guns over there on the ground. We got some cantaloupe. We got some sweet potato chips. We got some hot dogs for the Bicky kids. All right, so we got everything going on here. So real simple. All we're going to do is open up the ribs. And we're going to serve it right in the tin foil. So I'll let you see what we have made here. Now you can see the steam, so they're still hot. And there they are. There they are, folks. Right? You notice we can just kind of pull it in the burnt. And it comes out. I'm getting hit by my wife. That's a usual thing here in the Marin household. That's right. She beats me. So that's it. And there they are, folks. So I hope you enjoyed the day of Marin ribs. You see the Nerf bolts flying behind me. Hope you guys have a great summer. And if you need anything, reach out to us. We miss you. See you guys.
thank the Lord for everything he's done and for everyone at the family table.